Hi there, and welcome back to the channel. In today's episode on exciting careers in power systems industry, we are going to discuss substation engineering opportunities. If you do a quick job search online for electrical engineering roles, you're definitely going to encounter job titles such as substation physical engineer, substation resident engineer, substation engineer, entry-level, mid-level, senior, substation design engineer, and so on. I will walk you through different roles and responsibilities of substation engineers, what are the different qualifications and requirements for this job, the pros and cons, some of the advantages and disadvantages of working as a substation engineer, and how you can make an entry into substation engineering. Substation engineering roles are typically found in electrical utilities or heavy industries who have their own substations and very large power system networks. Indirectly, you can work as a substation engineer through a consulting firm, an engineering design firm, EPCM, MEPs, who have electrical utilities as their clients. At a high level, substation engineers work within multidisciplinary teams. They have to interact with operations, maintenance, engineers with other specializations, project managers, safety personnel, controls engineers, and other stakeholders. Their job responsibilities typically include a fine balance of design work as well as hands-on field engineering. They may be expected to develop substation electrical drawings, maintain them, design equipment layouts, provide site support, participate in commissioning activities, engage in different phases of medium to high voltage transmission design, provide support during the permitting process, and oversee the construction of substation projects. A fair portion of your roles and responsibilities as a substation engineer actually involve reviewing electrical drawings. Substations contain big ticket, large ticket electrical items such as transformer station, you'll have switch gears, different types of breakers, bus work, maybe capacitor banks, reactors. All of them are specialized, high ticket, expensive electrical equipment with long lead items that need to be specified, installed, and commissioned very carefully. Project managers will be relying on your expertise to make sure that all of the equipment that they're procuring for the project meets the technical requirement. Project schedulers and coordinators will be interested in making sure that there is no delay in delivery. Sometimes if there's a delay in vendor's design, you'll have to step up and work closely with them in order to make sure that you can recover some of the time. It's a team effort, and as I mentioned, it requires you to wear different hats and perform different roles and responsibilities and engage with professionals with different specializations, academic backgrounds, and experiences. You will also be required to perform quality reviews of electrical engineering work that is performed by other subcontractors and consultants. In order to get the electrical construction side of things taken care of, you will have to create scope of work documents for contractors. They take the form of construction drawing packages that are prepared for bidding, and once the bidding is done, you will receive incoming submittals that you will have to review from different contractors. You'll have to provide your input for technical compliance. If one of the bids is not technically viable, you'll have to initiate clarifications, give them an opportunity to update their bids and pricing, and once all of the bids are leveled, you will be making your technical recommendations. When it comes to other engineering disciplines, all of these big ticket electrical items such as transformers, switch gears, reactors, capacitor banks, battery rooms require foundation and typically need to be anchored. And this is where you'll have to provide details around weight, dimensions to structural and civil engineers in a timely manner. Similarly, if you are housing some of the electrical equipment indoors in an electrical room, HVAC engineers, mechanical engineers will be interested in learning about the heat loss of different electrical equipment. All of these details you'll have to seek from vendors. In some cases, you'll have to do your own estimation and provide them as input to their design, i.e. the design of civil engineers, structural engineers, how much concrete they have poured, and also to the design of HVAC engineers who have to size air conditioning. You'll have to carry out all of these responsibilities while making sure that your design and execution is code compliant. You'll be working with NEC, NESC, and applicable NERC standards or any other regional standards that apply within your jurisdiction. So typically, what is it that the employers are looking for in terms of qualification when it comes to substation engineering job opportunities? Typically need to have 4 years of undergraduate bachelor's of engineering degree from an accredited college or university. For an entry-level substation engineering role, employers are open to hiring recent graduates, especially when they have senior engineers on the team, because they know that in a matter of few years, these junior engineers can be trained. For mid-level or intermediate roles, they're looking for at least 5 years of experience, and a good quality experience will basically show show progression in terms of responsibilities and the type of projects that you would have completed by that point. And typically for a senior role as a substation engineer, you're looking at least 10 plus years of experience. A lot of employers in the US prefer the candidates to have EIT certificate, which is obtained after passing your FE exam. And if you're an electrical engineer, most likely you'll be going for FE electrical and computer exam. For more senior roles, the requirements are typically PE license, which is obtained after passing the FE exam and the PE power exam and having met your state's requirements, which are typically 4 years of verifiable experience, references, background check, credential evaluations, and so on. When you combine experience with expertise with credentials, your profile will be highly desirable and attractive for a lot of employers. As you probably know, I help students prepare for FE Electrical and Computer as well as the PE Power exam. And a lot of my students work for utilities within their substation departments. In contrast, when you work for owner's engineers, you're basically part of an in-house engineering team. And a lot of times you will have other consultants working for you. One of the disadvantages of substation engineering jobs, because of the fact that substation engineering jobs have field component, site component involved as well, they offer opportunities for overtime, especially during commissioning and startup phase. Now, if your schedule allows you to make some extra money by working a little bit more, then it may be considered positive. But the downside is that not every engineer prefers to work in the field on the site, and if the expectation is that you're going to be doing overtime on a regular basis as compared to working exclusively out of an office environment, then substation engineering may not be for you. Like any other job, there are pros and cons, and depending on the stage of life you're in and your personality, a disadvantage for someone may be an advantage for you and vice versa. And if you want to learn more about preparation of FE Electrical and Computer exam and the PE Power exam, then check out these playlists over here. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you soon in the next video.